Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillah rabbil alameen. Wa salatu wa salamu ala Sayyidina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Amma ba'd. So today's lecture will be somewhat interesting and different from the previous ones because we will go into a tangent about fiqh and theology because of the incident of the wars of the Ridda. And before I jump into that tangent, which will be the most of the lecture, let's just recap. What are we talking about? We're talking about the issue of Abu Bakr As-Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu fighting the people who basically left Islam after the death of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And I said last week that these were divided into three categories. The first category were those who returned to paganism and worshipping idols. This is the first category. The second category were the false claimants of the prophets. Okay, these are the false prophets like Musaylama al-Kadhab and his wife whose name was Sajjah. And the third that we did not talk about, and that is Tulayha al-Asadi. I will just begin with his story right now after we finish this introduction. This is the second category of the people who Abu Bakr fought. There is a third category, and that category has caused a huge controversy in Islamic theology and in fiqh. And that is the category of those who did not leave Islam, at least verbally. They did not believe in a false prophet, but they simply refused to pay zakat. The mani'i az-zakat. They refused to pay zakat. So we'll talk about that controversy after we finish the most famous of the prophets after Musaylama and Sajjah. The next one is Tulayha al-Asadi. And Tulayha al-Asadi was the third most famous of these false prophets. And we're not going to talk about the others. There were other minor figures here and there. And there's not much to be said about them other than they all were killed. Tulayha al-Asadi was one of the few who also pretended to be a prophet. In fact, he fought in the Battle of Trench, the Battle of Ahzab, but not on the side of the Muslims. He was a mushrik on the other side. So he came all the way from Najd and he participated in the Battle of the Trench. And after this, he accepted Islam in the lifetime of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but he never visited the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So he was not a Sahabi. He never saw the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. After the death of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he then proclaimed prophethood. So Tulayha then proclaimed he is the new prophet and he is the prophet to the tribes of Ghatafan and the tribes of At-Tay. And Khalid ibn al-Walid was sent to vanquish him. And when he heard of Khalid's arrival, he fled and he went to Syria where he repented and he accepted Islam again. So Tulayha was the only male that we know of that, because Sajjah also did the same thing, that proclaimed to be a prophet and then outside of the folds of the law, because if the law catches you, there is no Tawbah for this. When he left the land of Islam, he went to Syria. Then in the land of the Romans, he then re-accepted Islam. And this demonstrates that he sincerely repented. And this shows us the power of repentance, that even somebody who falsely claims to be a prophet, the Islamic State is not going to punish them. And this was the reality of the early claimants of prophethood, who then repented. And he came back for Umrah in the time of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. In other words, the next year, he came back for Umrah. And he was so embarrassed because of his own sins, he did not even visit Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. And he regretted his actions. He eventually made his way into the Sahaba, into the realm of Umar ibn al-Khattab. Abu Bakr had passed away. And Umar ibn al-Khattab, because Tulayha was a commander, a leader, a general, I mean, obviously all of the claimants of Prophet, by the way, all of them were very charismatic leaders. That's why they wanted more power for themselves. And many of them, like Tulayha, was like known for his bravery in war, his war tactics. He was a soldier, if you like. And when he embraced Islam again and he repented, Umar ibn al-Khattab told the Sahaba, and specifically he told Khalid ibn Walid, to take advantage of this person in the wars against the Romans and the Persians. But he said to Khalid ibn al-Walid, he said, never make him the leader of the army. In other words, yani, learn from your lesson, don't put him all the way at the top, just make him a lieutenant or something like this. So Tulayha then became famous in the time of Umar ibn al-Khattab for participating in both of the battles of Yarmouk and Qadisiyah, which we'll talk about inshallah when we talk about Umar al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, the battles of Yarmouk and the battles of Qadisiyah. And of course, the battles of Yarmouk and the battles of Qadisiyah were the two most important and famous battles in the time of the Khulafa, because the both of them opened the way for conquering Rome and Persia, the Roman Empire and the Persian Empire. So the battle of Yarmouk and the battle of Qadisiyah, memorize these names, and we will inshallah talk about them when we get to the story of Umar ibn al-Khattab. And Tulayha, this guy who claimed to be a prophet, he's not a Sahabi, he claimed to be a prophet, he repented, and eventually he died a shaheed in the battle of Nahawand. And the battle of Nahawand in the 21st year of the Hijrah was the decisive final nail in the coffin against the Sassanid Empire. For 350 years, the Persians had this glorious civilizations, and it all came to an end within a few years when the Muslims attacked, beginning with the Battle of Qadisiyah and basically ending with the Battle of Nahawand. And Tulayha was one of the main figures in this fight against the Persians, against the Sassanids. So he died a shaheed, and inshallah, we hope Allah Azza wa Jalla accepted his tawbah. He seemed to be sincere after his false claim of prophethood. Okay, these are the three main false prophets. There were others, we will not talk about them. For the rest of today, I will actually go into a tangent because I find it very interesting, and also because my specialty is aqidah, so obviously this is all what I find personally very interesting anyway, and because it is directly linked to the incident of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. What happened in the time of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq actually generated a intellectual controversy, a controversy of ideas amongst later scholars. Now, what is this incident and what is the controversy? The incident is as follows. We said there were three groups of people. The first two of categories, without any doubt, they are not Muslim. To go back to idolatry, you don't need to have any knowledge to know you're not a Muslim if you worship an idol. To believe in a false prophet, we said last week and 2 weeks ago, that to believe in a false prophet instantaneously expels you from Islam. Because a false god and a false prophet, these are the two things that you don't need any alim to give you a fatwa. If a person believes in another god besides Allah, it doesn't matter if he calls himself a Muslim, he's not a Muslim. You see what I'm saying? If a person believes in any prophet after the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it doesn't matter what he says. If he says, I believe in a Nabi or a Rasul or whatever his reinterpretation is, if he believes in somebody whom Allah gives wahi to after the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then this person is simply not a Muslim. So these two categories, clearly, they are not Muslims. The issue comes with the third category of people. And these were large groups of tribes who had embraced Islam, and they did not leave Islam, nor did they go back to idolatry or believe in the false prophets. They simply said, I'm not going to give my money to you, O Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. I would have given it to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but I'm not going to give it to you. I don't believe that you are qualified or legitimate that I should give my zakat to you. Why? What was their evidence? They had some Quranic evidence, believe it or not. They used the verse in Surah Tauba that Allah says, خُذْ مِنْ أَمْوَالِهِمْ صَدَقَةً تُطَهِرُهُمْ وَتُزَكِّهِمْ بِهَا وَتُصَلِّ عَلَيْهِمْ وَصَلِّ عَلَيْهِمْ فَإِنَّ صَلَاتَكَ سَكَنٌ لَهُمْ. Take, Ya Rasulullah, خُذْ is in the singular. One person Allah is speaking to. O Messenger of Allah, take their money, صَدَقَ money. خُذْ مِنْ أَمْوَالِهِمْ صَدَقَة. تُطَهِّرُهُمْ, it will purify them, and cleanse them, and pray for them, for your prayer is a peace upon them. They said, Allah only commanded the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to accept our zakah, not you. And your salah upon us, your dua for us, is not the same as the dua of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So why should we give it to you? So they have a Quranic evidence that they have bizarrely interpreted. Now here's the key point. When a person rejects the Quran, no doubt the person's a kafir. When a person wants to reinterpret the Quran, this demonstrates that he believes the Quran is true. But he's trying to find a way out, he's trying to find in a different wording. This is not a rejection. In Arabic, this is called ta'wil. And the chapter of ta'wil is a huge chapter, and you will give somebody excuses for ta'wil that you can never give for rejection, straight out rejection. You understand the difference between the two, right? The rejection in Arabic is called takdib. You just reject, kadhaba. And ta'wil is you reinterpret. So to have ta'wil means that you accept this is from Allah, but you have a different understanding than the person next to you. And to call that kufr is not that easy. And there are some bizarre ta'wils, believe it or not. In fact, and again, just to give you an idea, it is a well-known incident. There was a companion, not one of the very famous Ashar Abu Bashar, one of the companions, who after the death of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he interpreted a certain verse in the Quran to imply that it was okay to drink alcohol. There is a certain verse in the Quran, Surah Al-Ma'idah, that يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَيْسَ عَلَيْكُمْ جُنَاحٌ فِيمَا طَعِمُوا إِذَا مَا اتَّقَوْا وَآمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ ثُمَّ اتَّقَوْا وَآمَنُوا ثُمَّ اتَّقَوْا وَأَحْسَنُوا لَيْسَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ لَيْسَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ جُنَاحٌ. There is no sin on the believers in what they eat or drink, فِيمَا طَعِمُوا, whatever they ingest, as long as they have taqwa and iman. Now the ayah basically, I mean, getting technically here, but the point is, in usul al-fiqh, there's something called general and there's something called specific, am and khas. And when you have a general verse and a specific verse, you accept the general verse and you take an exception from the exceptional verse. So if Allah is saying there's no problem for the believers to eat whatever they want, this is a general verse. Then in a specific prohibition, Allah says, don't eat pig. This is khas. So we say, you can eat everything other than pig. And the more exceptions we find, the more we'll keep on saying, other than this. Point is, this is the science of usul al-fiqh, or how you derive fiqh. Okay? And this is a science that is developed like all sciences. And there are differences of opinion. Now, this particular companion, and he was not known for being a faqih or an alim. He's just a companion who has good in him. And there's much good that he has done. He misinterpreted this verse and he said, Allah is clearly saying that as long as you are pious and you believe, you can eat and drink whatever you want. So my point is, and of course the Sahaba did not accept this from him, and Umar ibn al-Khattab reprimanded him and stopped this interpretation. And there are other bizarre interpretations that we find without, again, these things shock the people when they hear them, but this is the reality that the Sahaba are humans and they're going to have some opinions that are human opinions, that is not very agreed upon by the majority. So this opinion as well is taken from the Quran. And the question arises, are these people who refuse to give zakat considered non-Muslims, i.e. murtad, or are they considered Muslims? This is the controversy. Now why is this a controversy? What is the issue behind here? Remember when I mentioned this hadith or the incident 2 weeks ago, that Umar ibn al-Khattab, he came to Abu Bakr as-Siddiq and he said that, O Abu Bakr, how can you fight the people when they have said La ilaha illallah? And you know that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, Umirtu an uqatil an-nasa hatta yashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa anni rasulullah, that I have commanded to do qital of the people until they say the shahada and they testify that I am the Rasulullah, and they fast and they pray and they give zakah. If they pray and they give zakah, then their lives and property are sacred, unless they commit a crime, meaning if they do some type of thing, and Allah will judge their affairs. This is the hadith, famous hadith. Umar said, O Abu Bakr, how can you fight the Ahl al-Ridda, or I should say Mani'i al-Zakah, the term is those who refuse to give zakah, when they clearly are saying the Shahada? They said La ilaha illallah. And Abu Bakr as-Siddiq said, Wallahi la uqatilanna man farraqa bayna salati wa zakah. I swear by Allah, I will do qital for those who differentiate between salah and zakah. And he said, this, they're not paying zakah, is from the haqq that the Prophet ﷺ said, that if they don't do it, then I'm allowed to fight them. So Umar ibn al-Khattab said, When I realized that Allah had turned the heart of Abu Bakr to fight them, then I saw that it was the truth. This hadith is in Bukhari and in Muslim. What is the controversy? The controversy is as follows. It is a completely theological controversy. So we're going to pause from the Abu Bakr story and finish it off inshallah next week. This is a completely theological controversy. The controversy is as follows. What does it mean to be a Muslim? What does it mean to be a believer? Who is a believer and who is an unbeliever? Who is a Muslim? Who is a kafir? What is the line between Islam and between kufr? And in particular, the controversy is, are actions a necessary requirement of being a believer or not? This is the controversy. Is it simply enough to say, I'm a Muslim and that's it, do nothing? Or must you follow it up with some actions? This is the controversy between many of the early groups, and it is a standard theological controversy between all of the spectrums of Islam. Whatever group that existed, from the Mu'tazila to the Jahmiya, to the Ash'ariya, to the Athariya, to the Maturidiya, to the Mu'tazila, every single group, everyone had a particular interpretation. So this opinion, or this issue, spans all of the Islamic groups, just like Qadr. Qadr and iman are the two big issues every single group differed over. No two groups basically have the same opinion. So the issue of iman as well is one of those controversial issues. And the position of Orthodox Sunni Islam is that actions are a necessary part of iman. Actions are a necessary part of iman. But not all actions, some actions. And the position of the Khawarij, all actions are a necessary part of iman. And the position of the opposite group, and they're called the Murji'ah. And the Murji'ah, they no longer exist, but their descendants exist. So that group dissolved, but then splinter groups came and they still exist. The Murji'ah said, no actions are a part of iman. These are the three main opinions. There are many finer details, and I'm gonna bore you if I go into all of those controversies. But this is all a part of theology. So what are the three main opinions again? From far right to far left. You have on the far right, the Khawarij. The Khawarij were the most fanatical. And the Khawarij said, every single action that Allah has commanded is a part of iman. So if you don't do those actions, then you have left iman. So if you drink, you take drugs, you womanize, you steal, you lie, you cheat, you become a kafir. This is the Kharijite position. Because all actions are a necessary part of iman. You see this point here, right? Where they're coming from. Okay? That's the one extreme. The exact flip opposite, no actions are a part of iman. So if you do absolutely nothing and you do every sin in the book, according to these people, as long as you acknowledge Allah created you and the Prophet is true and there's a day of judgment, they literally said, and I know this sounds absolutely bizarre and unbelievable, but this is their position. Because if you think about it, that is their, it makes sense if you think about it from their paradigm. Your iman as a murderer and rapist and drug dealer and whatnot is exactly the same as the iman of Jibreel and the Prophet. Astaghfirullah. But think about where they're saying. That if actions are not a part of iman, then you believe Allah created you, Jibreel believes Allah created, you believe the Prophet is true, Jibreel believes the Prophet is true. So just like a light switch with the either the it's binary, 0-1. You either have the one or you don't. If you have the ones, then you all have the ones, then they're matching. This is their opinion, the exact opposite side. Okay? We Ahl Sunnah held a middle position. And this is one of the very few areas where even Ahl Sunnah has a spectrum of opinion over. Usually Ahl Sunnah, its aqeedah is unified. Usually. In some areas, even Ahl Sunnah has a spectrum. Obviously the spectrum is not that bizarre, but it's a little bit. And this spectrum involves over what is the minimal amount that is required to be a Muslim. Ahlul Sunnah, by and large, they said that you must have some actions to be a Muslim. Clear. Footnote, some people said you don't need to have any actions, even of Ahlul Sunnah. Some people said this. But this is a very small opinion. The bulk of Ahlul Sunnah, they said, you need some actions. The question is, how much do you need? What is the minimal requirements? And as for their evidences, there are plenty of evidences to indicate that actions are a necessary part of iman. Of them, and I said this yesterday when we were doing the khatira, one of the most explicit evidence is the Surah Baqarah verse 143, where the Sahaba, when the change of Qibla came from Jerusalem to Mecca, the Sahaba said, O Messenger of Allah, those Sahaba who died before this verse came down, and they used to pray facing Jerusalem, will Allah accept their salah? Will Allah accept their salah? And Allah revealed, Surah Baqarah verse 143, وَمَا كَانَ اللَّهُ لِيُضِيعَ إِيمَانَكُمْ. Allah will not cause your iman to go to waste. So Allah called their salah their iman, thus equating their salah with their iman. Thus saying, if they didn't have salah, they wouldn't have iman. So literally, salah and iman are used as synonym here. If they didn't have salah, they wouldn't have iman. And in Surah Ar-Rum, second verse, Allah says that, did man think, Alif Lam Mim Ghulibat Ar-Rum, أَحَسِبَ النَّاسُ أَنْ يُتْرَكُوا أَنْ يَقُولُوا آمَنَّا وَهُمْ لَا يُفْتَنُونَ. Did man think that we would only want him to say that he believes, and we would not test him, and that he would be left like this? وَلَقَدْ فَتَنَّ الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِهِمْ. We have tested those before, we're going to test you. Meaning Allah is saying he is not satisfied with merely saying, I'm a Muslim, I'm a mu'min. أَحَسِبَ النَّاسُ أَنْ يُتْرَكُوا أَنْ يَقُولُوا آمَنَّا. Do you think iman is only to say, I believe? Also in the Quran, in Surah Al-Bayyinah verse 5, Allah says, وَمَا أُمِرُوا إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُوا اللَّهَ مُخْلِصِينَ لَهُ الدِّينَ حُنَفَاءَ وَيُقِيمُوا الصَّلَاةَ وَيُؤْتُوا الزَّكَاةَ وَذَلِكَ دِينُ قَيِّمًا. They have only been commanded to worship Allah and pray and give zakah, and that is the religion. So Allah made shahada and salah and zakah the religion. Okay? And in Surah Tauba, when Allah Azza wa Jal says that the mushrikun have to leave Arabia, the Arabian Peninsula, except for those who repent. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that, except for those who repent, that إلا من تاب وآمن. إلا من تاب وآمن. No, what is it? That's Surah Furqan. In Surah At-Tawbah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that فَإِذَا سَلَقَ الْأَشْهُرُ الْحُرْمُ فَاقْتُلُوا الْمُشْرِكِينَ حَيْثُ وَجَدْتُمُوهُمْ وَخُذُوهُمْ وَاحْصُرُوهُمْ وَاقْعُدُوا لَهُمْ كُلَّ مَرْصَدٍ فَإِنْ تَابُوا وَأَقَامُوا الصَّلَاةَ وَآتَوُا الزَّكَاةَ فَإِخْوَانُكُمْ فِي الدِّينِ. So Allah Azza wa Jal clearly is talking about the pagans, the idol worshippers. Then Allah says, فَإِنْ تَابُوا, if they repent, from what? Shirk. وَأَقَامُوا الصَّلَاةَ وَآتَوُا الزَّكَاةَ, and they pray, and they give zakah, then فَإِخْوَانُكُمْ فِي الدِّينِ, then and only then they become your brethren in faith. Which clearly indicates if they didn't pray and they didn't give zakah, they would not be your brethren in faith. And there are over 70 verses in the Quran. Every one of you has memorized some of them. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ. Never in the whole Quran does Allah say إِنَّ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا, and then not follow it with عَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ. Iman and amal are always, always, always paired together to indicate what? That actions and iman go hand in hand. So, to be very explicit, there are four theoretical scenarios. Okay? Four theoretical scenarios. Understand this point, you'll understand the whole controversy. First scenario, you believe in your heart and you act outwardly according to the laws of Islam. What is this? No, what is this? If you believe and you act, this clearly iman. Clearly you're a Muslim. No ikhtilaf, right? If you believe in your heart and you act according to Islam, no ikhtilaf. Second scenario, you don't believe in your heart that Allah created you and you don't act. Clearly kafir, no difference of opinion. Third scenario, you don't believe at all, but outwardly you act. Munafiq, hypocrite, clear? This is no controversy, everybody agrees to this. It's the fourth scenario where the controversy exists. The fourth scenario is, you believe in your heart that Islam is true, that the Prophet ﷺ is a prophet, that the Quran is wahi from Allah, that there is a day of judgment, that Allah created you, but you do not do anything of the arkan of Islam. This is the controversy. Apologize, I still have the allergies. This is the controversy. Orthodox Sunni Islam says this scenario is not called iman. You understand this point? This scenario is close to iman, but it's not iman. This is maybe somebody who's thinking about converting, maybe, but we would not consider him to be a Muslim. Even if he says he's a Muslim, he's not a Muslim, according to this opinion. You understand this point? Because to be a Muslim, you have to demonstrate in your actions. This is what Orthodox Sunni Islam says. Other versions, and there are opinions even within some people who are within the general fold of Sunni Islam, they say that this person is a Muslim and he's a sinful Muslim and Allah might forgive him on the Day of Judgment. This is the controversy. So the point being, Orthodox Islam, Sunni Islam says, inner belief and outer actions are linked together. You cannot have one without the other. Inner beliefs and outer actions go hand in hand. And I'll give you a simple example that clearly demonstrates that emotions and actions go hand in hand in every sane person. Suppose a person knew that his children were in danger, and he sees or he knows that he can save them from that danger, and that danger is fatal, it's lethal. Will anyone who is a father or mother, I mean anybody, or we're not talking about bizarre madmen, but anybody who's a father or mother just sit there and do nothing? It's impossible. Theoretical knowledge will result in action when there are necessary emotions. You see the point? When you have this knowledge, it will, it's human psychology, it will result in actions. So, according to Sunni Islam, true belief in Allah and the Day of Judgment and Jannah and Jahannam requires you to prepare for that day at some bare minimal level. If you do not prepare for that day, then your mere knowledge is devoid of any actual, tangible fruits and meaning. And you might as well not have that actual knowledge. And they give many, and again, much can be said here. And as I said, this reality, this controversial topic, much has been written about this. Literally, so many volumes have been written, many PhDs and dissertations. My own master's dissertation, not my PhD, my master's dissertation has an entire chapter of, I don't know, maybe 70, 80 pages just on this issue of iman, because the guy that I studied had his position as well. And we're going into all of these issues. So much has been written. This is one of the, as I said, big controversial areas of Islam about what is the line between Islam and kufr. And what is kufr on the one side? And this line in the middle is the controversy. Everybody agrees if you're practicing and praying, whether or not you're a Muslim. Everybody agrees if you reject, you're a kafir. This area in the middle, which is the fine line, this is where the controversy occurs. Now, what has Abu Bakr as-Siddiq and this issue got to do with this whole controversy? Are you guys seeing where this is heading? Right? Abu Bakr as-Siddiq and his fighting against those who did not pay zakah is the primary evidence that is used by those people who say that the minimal requirements of being a Muslim are the Salah and the Zakah, or even the Salah and the Zakah and the fasting and the Hajj, all the Arkan basically. So the incident of Abu Bakr becomes the primary theological evidence for this opinion. Because according to them, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq is including them in Ahl al-Ridda. And the wars are called the wars of Ridda. And he tells Umar ibn al-Khattab, Wallahi, I will fight them. And he fights them and he kills them. So this would seem to demonstrate that the Sahaba viewed the one who does not give zakat as being a kafir, which would support the position that the minimal requirements of Islam are more than just belief, but they are actions. So, and by the way, and again, you should know, all of this stuff is useful knowledge. You should all know these are the interpretations of our faith, and realize that there are, for the purposes of this one class, I'll summarize, there are three opinions within Orthodox Sunni Islam that are acceptable. So within Sunni Islam, this is one of those controversies that exists within our own tradition. There are three opinions. The first opinion, and I would say this is the majority opinion clearly, is that the minimal requirement to be a Muslim is to pray, or to even on-off pray, not necessarily all five prayers, but just to be somewhat regular in your prayers. Pray like semi-regularly. At least this person, we consider him to be a Muslim. And according to this opinion, the one who never prays any salah, he never lowered his head to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, such a person is simply not considered a Muslim. And by the way, this is a very strong opinion. And all you need to do is to think of the issue of Iblis, where Allah commanded him to do one sajda. And this was a command of a sajda. And the sajda was not even to Allah, it was to Adam. But Allah commanded him to do one sajda. And Iblis felt too arrogant to obey Allah's command to do sajda. So because of one sajda, Iblis is considered a kafir. As one of the scholars of the past said, I believe it was Sufyan ibn Uyayn, I'm not sure. He said, so Iblis kafir because of one sajda. So how about the one who is called to do over 30 sajdas every day? And he keeps on finding an excuse not to do sajda. And it's simple food for thought, right? That Allah is requiring you to prostrate your head and you continue to say, and our Prophet ﷺ said, Allah has made it haram for the fire of hell to eat any of the sajda parts, the parts of sajda, right? And you will be recognized by, according to some reports, the sajda parts as well as the wudu parts. So this is the first opinion, that the criterion for to be a Muslim is to say the Shahada and to pray at least some of the prayers. And this is also proven in Surah Al-Qiyamah, فَلَا صَدَّقَ وَلَا صَلَّى وَلَكِنْ كَذَّبَ وَتَوَلَّى. He neither gave charity nor did he pray. And by the way, every evidence used here is also going to be used in the second opinion, which is obvious, which is that you have to pay zakat as well. Surah Al-Muddathir, verse 42. When the angels say, how did you end up in Jahannam? قَالُوا مَا سَلَكَكُمْ فِي سَقَرْ. What do the people of Jahannam say? قَالُوا لَمْ نَكُمْ مِنَ الْمُصَلِّينَ. We were not of those who used to pray. Surah Al-Mursalat, verse 48. وَإِذَا قِيلَ لَهُمْ ارْكَعُوا لَا يَرْكَعُونَ. When it is said to them to make ruku', they do not make ruku'. So Allah considered these people non-Muslims because they don't bow down and they don't do sajda. They don't bow down and they don't do sajda. Also, Surah Al-Baqarah, verse 143, we also mentioned this, that Allah called their iman, He called it their salah, He called it their iman. And Imam Al-Bukhari says, so this is clearly Imam Al-Bukhari's opinion, Imam Al-Bukhari says, no other action has been called iman other than salah. Allah literally, synonymously used the term iman to talk about the term salah. No other action has just been eclipsed and used by the term iman other than salah. And Ibn Mas'ud and others said Ibn Mas'ud's student said that the Sahaba did not consider any of the actions to leave it to be kufr other than the salah. Other than the salah. So, and also the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, which is in Sahih Muslim, بَيْنَ الرَّجُلِ وَبَيْنَ الرَّجْلِ وَالْكُفْرِ وَالشِّرْكِ تَرْكُ الصَّلَةِ. Between a man and kufr and shirk is leaving the salah. Between a man and kufr and shirk is leaving the salah. So quite literally, kufr and shirk and salah is the line. So all of these evidences seem to suggest that the salah is a necessary part of Islam. This is the first opinion. The Al-Ahd Al-Ladhi Bainahu Wabainahu. So we can go on and on. Ibn Al-Qayyim has the most comprehensive book ever written in the history of mankind about this issue. It is called The Ruling on the One Who Abandons the Prayer. It's a mini volume. Hukmu Tarik As-Salah. An entire volume that is dedicated to every single evidence. And he has dozens of evidences. And if you read the book, I mean, honestly, it is difficult not to be completely convinced that definitely at least position one is right. And honestly, it makes sense because, this is clearly, I sympathize with the first and then later on other positions as well, but clearly number one, simple reason. What is the kalima? La ilaha illallah. What does it translate? There is no deity worthy of worship other than Allah. Okay, so if a person says it, show the worship. Show the worship. If you don't show the worship, then how have you really believed in the kalima? And the ultimate symbol of worship is what? To take your noblest part of the body, and that is your head, and to physically put it in the sand and in the dust where people walk, so that you show Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that you have no arrogance when it comes to worshipping Him. This is the essence of ibadah. And that is why the salah, the main point of the salah is the sajda. Right? That's the only thing we actually do twice in every rak'ah. To illustrate this is the purpose of the salah, is the sajda. So when you say La ilaha illallah, show us the ibadah. If you don't have the ibadah, where is the La ilaha illallah? You're saying there's no deity worthy of worship other than Allah, show us the worship. You don't have any worship if you're not actually praying. And any other trivial good deed does not compare to the actuality of the salah. So this is the first opinion, that to be a Muslim, you have to have the shahada and also to pray at least semi-occasionally, have some type of regularity of the salah. This is what it means. The second opinion is, and this is where Abu Bakr incident is used, is it is the salah and the zakah to be a Muslim. You must pray and give zakah. And what is their evidence? Firstly, all of the evidences used in the previous opinion can also be used here. Of them, فَلَا صَدَّقَ وَلَا صَلَّى وَلَكِنْ كَذَّبَ وَتَوَلَّى. He neither gave charity nor did he pray. He neither gave charity nor did he pray. Rather, he rejected and turned away. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Bayyinah, وَمَا أُمِرُوا إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُوا اللَّهَ مُخْلِصِينَ لَهُ الدِّينَ حُنَفَاءَ وَيُقِيمُوا الصَّلَاةَ وَيُؤْتُوا الزَّكَاةَ. وَذَٰلِكَ دِينُ الْقَيِّمَةِ. That is the true religion. What is the true religion? Salah and zakah combined together. Salah and zakah combined together. And in Surah Tauba, when we talked about the mushrikun, what does Allah say? فَإِن تَابُوا وَأَقَامُوا الصَّلَاةَ وَآتَوُوا الزَّكَاةَ فَإِخْوَانُكُمْ فِي الدِّينِ. Allah put two conditions. If they do those two conditions, then they are your brethren in faith. And those are salah and zakah. And in the Quran, in over three dozen verses, Allah pairs together that those who aqamu salata wa atawu zakah. Even in Surah Al-Baqarah, the first verse, Alif Lam Mim, ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ الْمُتَّقِينَ الَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْغَيْبِ وَيُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةَ وَيُؤْتُونَ الزَّكَاةَ. So, salah and zakah are paired together throughout the whole Quran. And this is Abu Bakr as-Siddiq saying, وَاللَّهِ لَأُقَاتِلَنَّ مَنْ فَرَّقَ بَيْنَ الصَّلَاةِ وَالزَّكَاةِ. This hadith is in Bukhari. I will fight against the one who differentiates between the salah and the zakat. Clear? Okay. So it appears that Abu Bakr as-Siddiq seems to be saying this as well. So this is where the incident of Abu Bakr becomes the theological issue. This is the second opinion. The first opinion is salah only. The second opinion is salah and zakah. The third opinion, and this third opinion seems to be Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal's, it is Ibn Taymiyyah's, Sa'id ibn Jubair's opinion and others, is that, in fact, theoretically speaking, it is the arkan, but realistically, how do you judge the arkan? you can only judge the Salah and the Zakah. So Salah and Zakah are the outward judges, because you cannot check if somebody is fasting or not. Nobody can check. Nobody monitors you. And you cannot check the Hajj, because again, it's not monitored. So what does the public monitor of you? Especially in Islamic State, what will it monitor? The Zakat is collected by the Islamic State. The Salah, everybody prays in Jama'ah. Men are supposed to pray in Jama'ah. Semi-regularly, they're supposed to be seen, whatnot. When the time for Salah comes, everything shuts down and you have to go and pray. If you just stand there and don't pray, this is a criminal offense if you don't pray for without a valid excuse. So, according to this third opinion, Salah and Zakah are merely outward mechanisms to check for the five arkan. And they say, what are the arkan other than necessary requirements for Islam? What does a rukun mean other than an essential component without which the whole building can never be built? So it makes no sense to take away one of the arkan and say, oh, salah only, or salah and zakah only. And so this position is that all five of the arkan, in fact, and this is actually in contrast to the belief of many average Muslims. Many average Muslims believe that if I don't pray and I don't fast and I don't, you know, give zakat, I'm a bad Muslim. Whereas what all three opinions are saying is that the one who doesn't pray out of laziness, he never prays. And alhamdulillah, the majority of the Muslim world prays at least irregularly. Would you agree with this? Part-time, yeah. Before the exam, they'll pray. Before the exam, before a job interview, they'll. The point is, there's something in their heart that occasionally, you know, they will go and they will pray. How many are the Muslims who will pray at least Jumu'ah? I would say a good percentage of Muslims, a good healthy percentage, pray at least Jumu'ah, or at least 2-3 Jumu'ahs. Maybe they're not that strict that if there's a meeting that they could get out of, they're embarrassed, they won't get out of it, right? But still, when there's the possibility to pray, I would say maybe 80% of the ummah. I don't know, is that a huge number? Maybe, but my guesstimate completely, at least 80% of the ummah will try to pray Jummah. Maybe they won't be regular, but they'll come if they're able to come. And Allah Azza wa Jalla knows. But the point is, a good amount of the ummah. So this demonstrates that we're really talking about those people that really have nothing to do with Islam. I mean, what percentage of the ummah fasts is in the 90s? And when you fast in the month of Ramadan, everybody prays some prayers. Even though unfortunately still some people don't pray five prayers in Ramadan. But at least like Maghrib, come on. I mean, I don't think anybody breaks the fast and doesn't pray Maghrib. Or am I that out of touch with that class of Muslims? I don't know. Because obviously I don't really mix with the... Even if they smoke, at least smoking is not like, okay, that's not... And astaghfirullah, there were people well known in history, they're called the Fus. I mean, there are groups that they would break their fast with sharab. I mean, it's something that they are addicts and they need it and they will do it. So they're doing a major sin in the month of Ramadan, but this isn't kufr. It's not kufr. You know, it's like that's they were addicts. The point being that I would guesstimate the bulk of the ummah, at least in Ramadan, shows signs of religiosity that inshallah, deep down inside, there's something in there. Right? Maybe even in the 90s, maybe in the 90%, that in Ramadan there's going to be some regular salah. So we're not talking about really large groups of Muslims. We're talking about those Muslims, and I think all of us know one or two people like that, some of us might know more such people like that, that they simply have nothing to do with Islam at all. They never ever pray. And they don't fast. And they claim to be Muslim. We're not talking about that group that makes fun of Islam and thinks themselves to be enlightened and like you backward people. These are murtads because they're mocking Islam anyway. We're not talking about that category, that who mock religion and religiosity. Yeah, these people are different. We're talking about the one who, if you were to ask him, are you Muslim? He says, of course I'm a Muslim. I just don't pray. This is the group we're talking about. I just don't fact. And how many percentage is that? Hardly any, I would say. Very small percentage. So the point being, these are the three opinions. Now, somebody can say, isn't the incident of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq so clear-cut? How could there be any ikhtilaf? Isn't it so clear-cut that he considered them to be non-Muslims and he fought them? How could there be ikhtilaf? And indeed, that is what some people say. And there are people from the very past, famous scholars such as Abu Ubaid al-Qasim al-Salam, Abu Ya'la from the Hanbalis, al-Jassas from the Hanafis and others, they say it is so explicit that Abu Bakr as-Siddiq fought these people because they were greedy for money. Not because they denied, not because they rejected, but simply they didn't want to pay zakah. This is also the position of the school of Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab and the Najdi school in Saudi Arabia. They also say Ibn Taymiyyah held this view, but Ibn Taymiyyah's view seems to be more nuanced. And their point is quite simple, and that is Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, he fought against this group in the same manner that he fought against Musaylamah. And in the same manner that he fought against the pagan idol worshippers. And that he considered them murtad. They're called Ahl al-Ridda. The wars are called the wars of Ridda. And according to this group, he took these people as prisoners of war. He permitted them to be killed. He permitted their wealth to be acquired. This is not done when you are fighting rebellious bad Muslims. This is done when you're fighting the murtads in classical fiqh. You do not take prisoners of war. You do not take the property if you're fighting people who are, it's called in Islam, yani either fasiq or ahl al-baghi. These are rebels. You don't do this. You only do it to the murtad, the one who says he was Muslim, then he left Islam. Ahl al-ridda, they are to be fought by the Islamic state. So this is the position of a group of scholars. However, believe it or not, the majority of the ummah does not accept this interpretation of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq's actions. And this is the standard position of most Hanbalis and Shafi'is and Malikis and some Hanafis. Some Hanafis felt with the first one. Imam al-Shafi'i was one of the earliest and most vocal critics of those who interpreted the other way. So we have his own writings. Imam al-Shafi'i wrote a famous book called Kitab al-Umm, massive volume of fiqh, many volumes of fiqh. And in this, he actually writes that the Sahaba, according to Imam Shafi'i, differentiated between people like Musaylama and people like the ones who did not give zakat. And they did not view them in the same manner. And this position has become the standard position, as I said, of most mainstream scholars, including Ibn Hazm, Ibn Abdul Barr, Al-Mawardi, Al-Baghawi, Al-Nawwi, Ibn Hajar, and I would argue even Ibn Taymiyyah held this view. Ibn Taymiyyah has a number of statements, it's a little bit ambiguous, where did he stand? But to me it appears that he's in the second group. And of their evidences, Imam al-Shafi'i says, look at the conversation between Umar ibn al-Khattab and Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. Umar ibn al-Khattab, he said, that how can you fight somebody who says the kalima? Is he viewing them kafir or Muslim? Muslim. So clearly Umar ibn al-Khattab is viewing them within the fold of Islam as being some type of sinners. But you're not supposed to fight them because they're saying the kalima. And Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, his response is not, how can you quote me this hadith, they're kafir. Rather, he is saying, and the famous phrase is that, wallahi, if they don't pay me one baby camel or one baby goat that they used to give to the Prophet ﷺ, I will fight them for that goat. Or I'll fight for that. Whatever was the standard of the Prophet ﷺ, the same amount they have to give me. And this seems to suggest, because he didn't say to Umar, how can you quote me this hadith? Their kalima means nothing to them. Rather, he said that their preventing of zakah is min haqqiha. Our Prophet ﷺ said, the hadith says that I cannot do qital to those who say the kalima except if they do something wrong. So Abu Bakr as-Siddiq is saying they are doing something wrong. He didn't say they're not saying the kalima or they're kafir. He is basically, according to Imam Shafi'i, he is saying they're saying the kalima and they're doing something that allows us to fight them. And Umar ibn al-Khattab is arguing basically that they are within the fold of Islam. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq seems to be responding as well that they are within the fold of Islam. And there's also some indication, some evidence to suggest that Abu Bakr as-Siddiq did not treat them the same way that he treated the murtads. This is a historical controversy. Did he take their prisoners of war or not? Did he take their wealth or not? And there is a controversy here. So this historical controversy becomes a theological controversy. You understand the point? Because if he took prisoners of war from amongst them, this means he considered them non-Muslims. And a number of explicit early reports indicates he did not take prisoners of war from them. And he did not take their wealth. And one of the most famous incidents that demonstrates this is the very controversial side incident. It doesn't have to do with Abu Bakr as-Siddiq directly, so we will not discuss it in a lot of detail. In fact, wanted to avoid it last week, but I realized this week I just have to mention it because it has this theological controversy. It is perhaps the most controversial thing when it comes to the biography of Khalid ibn al-Walid. It doesn't have to do directly with Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, so I didn't want to discuss it in his biography. But it happened in his time. And it is one of the big issues of early Islamic history that also becomes within Sunni Shia differences as well, and within those who want to make fun of the Sahaba and denigrate their status. And it's a side issue. In summary, in nutshell, there are reports of history. By the way, guys, do you see why I don't want to talk about history? You see now, all of you who are saying history, 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 now do you see why it's not what you guys think it is? And it is simply better to let bygones be bygones, rather than drudge it up and then mention it bit by bit. It's not something that, and I also disagree with the methodology of many of our scholars who want to romanticize and paint a very glorious picture by skipping over very difficult topics and by, you know, painting a very positive light. The problem comes, perhaps in a different time and era that would be fine. The problem comes when you hear about incidents from the other side, from non-Muslims or even people of other persuasions. And these incidents are found in Ibn Kathir al-Tabari. They're found in, Ibn Taymiyyah mentions them. These are not things that are being manufactured. And you or your sheikh has presented this glorious painting. You either reject your sheikh or your version of Islam, and you think these are all a bunch of liars because that's what you've been taught, or astaghfirullah, it shakes your iman and you leave Islam because there is no third alternative. And I'm not the type to paint you a false picture. That is why even in the seerah, I would go into every controversy, because it is my belief and the belief of all of us that whatever the Prophet ﷺ did is valid and legitimate, and we will defend it. But here's the point. Each individual sahabi doesn't hold that status. An individual sahaba can and did make ijtihad mistakes. And those mistakes don't have to be defended. That's the difference. They have to be defended, not each opinion. You see the difference here, right? They as a whole have to be defended. And each sahabi, we say that even if he made a mistake, it is forgiven in the amount of good that this person did. But it is possible that individual sahaba, not it is possible, it is true that individual sahaba are going to commit individual sins. Individual sahaba are going to commit individual sins. Even the fuqaha of the sahaba are not malaika. They will make mistakes, and there's going to be things that are going to happen. So with this prelude, what exactly happened? What is the controversial point? So one of the most powerful and famous chieftains of the tribe of the Banu Tamim, and the Banu Tamim is one of the most powerful tribes. Okay, so we're talking about one of the big shots, if you like, or one of the heads of the entire Arabian Peninsula. His name was Malik ibn al-Nuwayra. His name was Malik ibn al-Nuwayra. And in fact, Malik ibn al-Nuwayra visited the Prophet ﷺ. The Prophet ﷺ appointed him to be the collector of zakah and the chieftain of his people, as he was, i.e. he came as a chieftain, he left as a chieftain. And he was one of the, as I said, the most influential people of the Arabian Peninsula. He was of those who refused to give zakat. Not the murtad, meaning if you, how you interpret it is the point. He clearly did not leave Islam. He did not believe in the false prophets, but he basically did not, he was of those who did not want to give zakat to Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq sent Khalid ibn Walid to him. Here is where it gets murky. The undeniable facts that Malik ibn Nuwayra and all of the leaders were chained up. tied up. And the command was given to take them back to Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. This is a fact. Most of them were taken back to Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. Malik ibn al-Nuwayra and a few of the chieftains were executed. How and why is the big controversy? And to make matters far more murkier, Khalid ibn Walid married the wife of Malik ibn al-Nuwayra at this instance. And it is said that she was of exceeding beauty and whatnot. So you understand where all of this is going and the problems that has happened because of this and all of these issues. And so now the whole issue is, did this actually happen? You have historians who are going back and forth. But these are the things that are mentioned. Some say that this was a mistake on the part of the executor. Khalid didn't mean to tell them to execute, and they misheard or mistook. Some say this, some say that. So this is all of this controversy has taken place. And frankly, it's not directly relevant to us because it's not related to Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. It's happened in his reign, in his time, and Abu Bakr as-Siddiq did not approve of this ijtihad of Khalid. And he said Khalid made a mistake. This is Abu Bakr as-Siddiq saying that Khalid made a mistake. This was his ijtihad, he made a mistake. Umar wanted to punish Khalid financially or something, and Abu Bakr as-Siddiq said, I mean, he made a mistake. I mean, there's no point now. It's a done deal. So the point is, the both of them did not agree with what Khalid had done. But in the end of the day, what happened, happened. And huge controversy there. But the point is that, and here is where we get to back to our theological issue. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq paid blood money, diya, to the family of Malik ibn al-Nuwayra. His children, they got the blood money. Now, so what, somebody says? Blood money is only given for the Muslim. Blood money is given for the Muslim. So, because Khalid was his commander, any mistake that the commander does, so the chieftain or the Khalifa has to take responsibility financial. Right, so he gave blood money even though Malik was of those who did not pay zakat. This clearly demonstrates that he did not view this group as being the same as the first two. Now Imam al-Shafi'i says, this is from Imam al-Shafi'i, straight from his umm. He says, if somebody asks us, why then were they called Ahl al-Ridda and the books mention Hurub al-Ridda, and these groups are included in them? Imam Shafi'i says, he responds, Shafi'i says, the term Ridda linguistically has many meanings, and it basically means to reject or to go back on, and these people rejected the caliphate. So they went back on their oath of allegiance. Not that they're murtad from Islam. Other scholars mention, this group was the smallest of the other two. So when you say Ahl al-Ridda and Hurub al-Ridda, you mean the bulk of them, and this group is just included in it. And it is allowed in Arabic and in English, when you describe a large group, you just say the majority of them were like this, and then the smaller group is included in them. So the point is, the term Ridda doesn't necessarily have to imply that each and every person in them was a murtad. And as well, this evidence is used that one group amongst them, when they were brought to Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, they said to Abu Bakr, this is not Malik's, another group, they said to Abu Bakr that we did not commit kufr after having embraced Islam, but we were just greedy for our money. Like, he literally said this to apologize. Said, we didn't intend to commit kufr. We just didn't want to give you our money. So, all of this put together seems to suggest that Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, and this is what I hold, now I'm going to clarify my specific position in a while, that it seems to suggest, and this is the majority opinion, that Abu Bakr as-Siddiq fought them as rebels and not as kuffar. This is the controversy. How did he fight them? Did he fight them because they're sinners and rebels? Because look, in an Islamic state, any community that causes fitna and fasad, a bunch of highway robbers, or people that are not paying zakat, you're going to fight them. There's no controversy that you're going to fight them, right? It's like, even in this country, if you don't pay taxes, and you refuse to pay taxes, the feds are going to come after you. There have been a number of instances even here where the feds actually attack and imprison you, right? If you refuse to pay taxes. That's the reality of any society. So the controversy is not whether Abu Bakr as-Siddiq attacked them. Of course he attacked them. The controversy is on what basis? Were they kafir or were they fasiq or basically bughat or the rebels? And the majority of scholars say they were rebels. And they use as evidence that the whole conversation between Umar and Abu Bakr seems to assume that they were within the fold of Islam. And he treated them in a different manner. There are other groups, as I said, the first group, the more strict or hardliners, and in particular in our times it is the group of Muhammad ibn Wahhab and the scholars of Najd. They're very strict about this point. They say these people were all kuffar, the ones who didn't pay zakat. And Abu Bakr treated them as kuffar. The bottom line is that Allah knows best, but it does appear that Abu Bakr as-Siddiq and Umar and the Sahaba did not view them as being kafir. They viewed them as being baghi, ahl al-fisq or ahl al-bughat, or people that are rebellious. And they did not treat them like the kuffar. And therefore, the issue comes, the Muslim who does not pay zakat out of greed, meaning for his own wealth, without denying its obligation, such a person could technically possibly still be a Muslim. So the bare minimum, and Allah knows best, and again, this is honestly one of those areas that I myself don't have a passionate opinion, because the evidences really are very strong in each camp. If you look at the evidence of the first opinion, Salah only, the second opinion, Salah and Zakah, the third opinion, all of the Arkan, you know, all of these evidences are very strong. And in the end of the day, just pray and give Zakah and leave the gray area to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, right? Do the Arkan, leave the gray area to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But it does appear that Abu Bakr as-Siddiq and others did not view this group as being kafir. Having said this, one final point to throw some salt, some spice into the mixture. If it's not spicy enough for you yet. It's not spicy yet? You don't eat spicy food, then there's no point talking to you about spiciness then. Little bit of controversy. It's one thing to say that if a person doesn't pay zakat out of greed, maybe this person is still a Muslim. But some scholars say, if a person is willing to go to war with the Islamic Khalifa because they don't want to pay zakah, you understand? The fact that they're so willing to lose their lives and to fight against the obligation of zakah, that is a rejection. And that might be kufr. And this actually makes a lot of sense. That the one who wants to go to war because a legitimate... Now, it's not as if they denied Abu Bakr as a Khalifa. It would be another thing, by the way, if there were groups of Khalifas, like once upon a time, and the one group said, we're not going to pay you guys zakat, we're going to pay our zakat to this Khalifa of ours. That's an issue of politics. This group didn't deny that Abu Bakr is a Khalifa even. They didn't deny that zakat, you know, is an obligation. They simply said, we want our money. That's what the point was. And they're willing to fight Abu Bakr as-Siddiq so that they don't give their zakat. Perhaps it could be argued some groups amongst these people were then treated as kuffar. Because to, as I said, it's one thing that you're lazy, you don't want to pay zakat. Imagine the Islamic State captures you. Imagine the Khalifa takes you. And you have to now, is going to attack you. And because you're not paying zakat. And you say, I don't care, I'm going to fight against Abu Bakr as-Siddiq so that he doesn't take my 5 camels from me. I mean, what does that demonstrate about your yaqeen in zakat? In fact, it could be interpreted as your rejection of zakat. And that's how some scholars interpret it. In any case, so the bottom line, and with this inshallah we'll conclude and then finish off inshallah the Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. And again, the main highlight of Abu Bakr's legacy radiallahu anhu, we'll talk about that next week, is that he kept the ummah together. He fought against all of these groups and salvaged the cohesion of the ummah. The one thing, and the second thing he did, which we'll talk about briefly as well next Wednesday, what is his most important legacy, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq? The Quran. These are, he saved the political unity of the ummah and he preserved the Quran for the ummah. This is the legacy of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. Allah Azza wa Jal blessed Islam politically and theologically or culturally or heritage-wise, scripturally. That Allah Azza wa Jal saved Islam politically and scripturally through Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. The honor of keeping the ummah one. Because had it not been for Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, had it not been for Allah Azza wa Jal's using Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, the ummah would have gone not just different ways politically, but even theologically. There would have been 30 versions of Islam. One is not praying zakah, one is not praying, one is not doing this, one is not doing that. Because Allah Azza wa Jal's preserving through Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, there has always been one consistent, what we call now Sunni Islam. The bulk of the world has remained similar in its ideology. Because Abu Bakr as-Siddiq said no difference of opinion about the arkan. We're all going to do these things together. So there was no ikhtilaf tolerated. And also the Quran as well, as you know, we'll talk about that inshallah next Wednesday. Final point from my side, I've already said this before that I'm taking a leave of absence from MIC in the month of May. I'll be on and in and out of the city, but I have to travel to literally 4 or 5 different countries and just too much is going on. So I decided to take a leave of absence. I will actually be here on next Wednesday. I'm going to be coming back on Monday, then leaving again on Thursday. So I'll be here next Wednesday, inshallah. So our last Abu Bakr as-Siddiq halaqa, and the one which we finish off, inshallah, his life and times and his death and his legacy, will be inshallah next Wednesday. Then we will pause, then Ramadan, and then inshallah we'll resume after Ramadan with Umar ibn al-Khattab and the rest of the Khulafa al-Rashidun. And as we said, we're going to do the Sahaba one by one, and then we'll get to the Ummahat al-Mu'mineen. So inshallah, that is the overall game plan, inshallah ta'ala. Any quick questions? Yes. So what is the difference if they were killed later on or not? No, they were killed. Malik ibn Nuwayra was killed as a prisoner of war. He was not killed in battle. He was killed chained. To kill a prisoner of war and then to marry his wife, and he is the chieftain, and he is a person of a very high status. It was a very controversial issue, and it still remains, by the way, to this day. It remains a hugely controversial issue. So some people say that he waited for the Ridda, and some say right then and there he made that wheel somehow, and did it right then and there. And this is again, like we said, it's just best to, there's no point bringing all of this up, you know. And that's a very awkward, this is the most awkward story in the reign of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. Nothing is more awkward than this, but it's not related to Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, alhamdulillah. It's not related to him. But it happened in his time, and he didn't agree to it. He did not like it. But the difference between Abu Bakr and Umar, radiallahu anhum, was what to do with Khalid now that he's done it. And Umar wanted to send a message, and Abu Bakr as-Siddiq said, he made an ijtihad, what can I do now? Meaning, I don't agree with his ijtihad, he made his ijtihad, now it's a done deal. Okay. Yes, Janabi.
These people who refuse to pay the zakat, and greed is the only motivation, doesn't make any sense. Because if you attend, what you're going to do with the money? I think maybe they just thought, because of the ayah you mentioned in the Quran, that you're going to pay the money only to Muhammad, the Prophet.
So they said.
So they thought maybe on the right path.
So they definitely had the Quranic ijtihad, and they strongly felt that only the Prophet has the right to take their zakat. خُذْ مِنْ أَمْوَالِهِمْ صَدَقَةً. So perhaps you are correct in this, we don't know. Perhaps they felt so passionately about this interpretation that they said, this is the truth and we will fight you for it. So the point being that they did not reject, from their perspective, Islam. They reinterpreted that zakat was only payable in the lifetime of the Prophet ﷺ. And every hadith and ayah about zakat, they said this meant to the Prophet ﷺ. Now that he's gone, then there is no zakat for us to pay anymore. Okay, so it is possible that this was their primary motivation, which is the defense of their particular opinion. And Allah knows best, inshallah. Final question, yes. So the question is, to rephrase, who gets to make takfir? And the response is, takfir is an ijtihad. Takfir is a personal opinion of a scholar. So if you understand that takfir is an ijtihad, then only a mujtahid makes takfir. Takfir is not the property of a person who doesn't have knowledge. The only exception to this, as I said, well, one can say there's two exceptions. The first exception is when a person does not consider himself to be a Muslim, then Muslims will consider this person not to be a Muslim. You don't need ijtihad when he's told you he's not a Muslim. So when a person who's not a Muslim tells you he's not a Muslim, there is no you doing takfir. This person has done it on himself, that this person is a non-Muslim. So there's no ijtihad there. The only time where there's going to be takfir for the masses to be able to do is when, as I said, certain groups have been unanimously considered outside the fold of Islam because they go against the two kalimas. And the examples of these groups are like the Duruz, for example. The Duruz are not, even though they might be coming from Islam, but they don't have the same beliefs or whatnot as us. And those who believe in a prophet after the Prophet ﷺ, we will not consider them to be within the fold of Islam, because you cannot believe in a God. So the Duruz believe that Ali is God manifest. When they say La ilaha illallah, they mean that Ali is Allah. That's their point. The one, the ilah for them is Ali. This is a really esoteric group that still exists. It doesn't matter. They believe that Ali came down in the form, or Allah, astaghfirullah, came down in the form of Ali, and that he's Ali, you know, Zahir and Batin. I mean, they have their bizarre theology. This group cannot be considered Muslim, because they don't believe in the Allah that we believe in. Similarly, a group that believes in a prophet after the Prophet ﷺ, same thing. So for these groups, you as an individual are not doing ijtihad. The scholars have said that these guidelines can be applied. Now, other than this, definitely, anybody who says La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah and he believes in the same God and the same prophet as you, it is no Muslim's business whatsoever to start talking about who's a Muslim and kafir. And this is one of the biggest problems of the Muslim world, that average people are now involved in takfir issues. And even this theoretical issue about people who don't pray and fast, we leave their affair to Allah at an individual level. This is just theoretical. It is not allowed for an average Muslim to apply it to any particular person. And we have had bizarre beliefs within Islam since the beginning of Islam. The Sahaba did not even consider the Khawarij to be kafir. Think about that. Even though the Khawarij killed and plundered and caused so much evil, they did not consider them to be kafir. Ali ibn Abi Talib was asked about the Khawarij. Akuffarun hum? Are they kuffar? He said, min al-kufri farru. They're running away from kufr. They're running away from kufr. How can they be kuffar? They're overzealous fanatics. They're running away from kufr. So the person asked, what are they? So Ali ibn Abi Talib said, hum ikhwanuna baghaw alayna. They are our brothers and they have transgressed against us. This is fiqh and maturity. The Khawarij are trying to kill Ali ibn Abi Talib and they eventually succeed. But Ali still says, they're not kafir just because they're bad people, just because they're murderers. They're fanatics, they're overzealous, but they're not outside the fold of Islam. So the dangers of takfir are what we see in the modern Muslim world. Civil war, bloodshed, everybody considering everybody a kafir. And unfortunately in our own land of Pakistan, it seems to be probably one of the worst places in the world. I don't understand why. Where every firqa and every group is just considering, just because of the most trivial of issues. I mean, sometimes the issues are fiqh related. You know, where to place the hands and ameen and whatnot. It goes into the level of becomes kufr. And this really shows a lack of even basic rudimentary knowledge of Islam. Kufr is to reject Allah and His Messenger, knowing you are rejecting Allah and His Messenger. Allah clearly says in the Quran, وَلَكِن مَن شَرَحَ بِالْكُفْرِ صَدْرًا. But rather the one whose chest opens up to kufr. That is the one. The hadith is, the ayah is applies to Ammar ibn Yasir. Remember when? Yes. Remember when Ammar ibn Yasir was tortured? And he said words of kufr. And Allah revealed in the Quran Surah An-Nahl, if you're forced, then it's not kufr. But if your heart wants to embrace kufr. Now, this ayah is very, very interesting. What it shows is that in order for you to be considered a kafir, your heart must desire kufr. Which means any person who desires Allah and His Messenger, to please Allah and to believe in the Messenger, by and large, if they are basically within La ilaha al-Muhammad Rasulullah, Ibn Taymiyyah has a statement that I don't make takfir of anybody who prays towards the Qibla. And the meaning of this phrase is not yani northeast versus southeast, because some groups pray southeast and whatnot, dear, right? The point is, I do not make takfir of anybody who shows any religiosity and lowers head to Allah. This is Ibn Taymiyyah's position. Even though Ibn Taymiyyah is perhaps the most vocal critic of every single group in Islam, from the Sufis to the Batinis to the Shia, he criticized everybody. But he said, I'm not calling them kafir. This is a really profound point. I mean, he's written volumes against extremist Sufis, extremist Shia, all of these groups. But he says, I don't consider them to be kafir. لا أكفر أحد من أهل القبلة. Anybody who prays towards the Qibla. And he also used to say, our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, nobody protects his wudu except he's a mu'min. So anybody who makes wudu, he must have iman. And I like these statements are very profound. The people of Qibla, the people of Salah, the people of wudu, we don't make takfir of them. Even if some of their beliefs are beliefs of kufr, we say Allah will judge them. Clear. We say Allah will judge them. Your belief is wrong. This you can say, no problem. You can say, your belief in this sheikh being, listening to your du'as and answering your du'as, that belief is kufr, you can say this. But that doesn't mean you become a kafir. There's a difference between kufr in generalities and specific kufr. And we do not pronounce specific kufr on any individual who has some type of perverse understanding of the Quran, even if it's perverse, even if it's bizarre, but he's still trying to understand the Quran. You quote any of, you know, any of these people, you meet them and they'll have some bizarre interpretations and they think this is what the Quran is telling them to do. So the point is, as long as they are within the Ahl al-Qibla, and if you look at these groups that are outside the fold of Islam, generally speaking they don't have the wudu. Generally speaking, they don't really have the salah. I mean, definitely the durus and whatnot don't have the salah. Of course, the big controversial point comes under our group there in our countries that believes in another prophet. They seem to have some rituals and not other rituals. Allah knows best about those rituals. But as we said, believing in another prophet. Now, I'm going to say something will definitely get me into trouble. But those amongst them who don't say they believe in another Nabi or Rasul, and they have their bizarre, weird terminologies, perhaps for them, perhaps we can say, let Allah judge their affairs, and we're not going to consider them to be non-Muslims. Even though I know that the scholars of our land would definitely not agree with what I'm saying. But I distinguish between those who explicitly say, so-and-so is a Nabi. For me, no question, end of story. No debate. Versus those who have their weird and bizarre terminology and they don't call him Nabi. And they don't call him Rasul. and they have their other ideologies. For this, perhaps we say this is a gray area, at least we can say for me, and leave the effort to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In any case, that in and of itself is going to cause at least 25 YouTube videos, 3 fatwas, 1 takfir against me. But anyway, Allah Azza wa Jal knows best, inshaAllah.